Would you like to live to be 100, as long as you're healthy, happy, and whole? The Bible says that the days of our lives are 70 years, or perhaps 80, if we're strong. But it's not unusual today to live much longer. At Lord of Life, we have more than 100 nonagenarians and 3 centenarians. This week's news reported that the world's oldest person, Japan's Kane Tanaka, died at the age of 119. We are living longer. That may be the biggest news of the past century. We are living longer, especially in affluent countries, due to better medicine, food, and work conditions. But the answer to the question about living longer is linked to living better. Most of us would say, yes, I would like to live longer so long as I am happy, healthy, and whole. This week, Tony and I are leaving on a belated and unfinished sabbatical. We were supposed to take the time in 2020, but the pandemic upended those plans. So we split the time between last summer and this summer. In addition to visiting family, we plan to visit 1 or 2 blue zones in the Mediterranean: Icaria, Greece, and/or Sardinia, Italy. What's a blue zone? It's a region where people routinely live better, longer. There are 5 blue zones worldwide: Okinawa, Japan, Sardinia, Nicoya, Costa Rica, Icaria, Greece, and Loma Linda, California. According to an article in Tuesday's Arizona Republic, researchers have identified the Power 9, 9 factors that overlap in all of these communities that appear to help with their longevity. An environment that naturally encourages people to move more, a sense of purpose in one's life, downtime to unwind from the day, the 80% rule, or stopping eating when your stomach is 80% full, a predominantly plant-based diet with small servings of occasional meat, moderate drinking and social happy hours, belonging to a faith-based organization, putting loved ones first, and having a strong social circle. Here's how my sabbatical can also become your sabbatical. I'd like to bring back some ideas for things that we can do to live better longer. We already have the faith base, an active community, strong social circles, and maybe too many happy hours. What we need is a little help adjusting to life's changes. How do you cook for one, especially when you're not the one who cooked before? And is there something healthier than frozen pizza or microwave dinners? Who knows, maybe while I'm gone, the pampered chefs will return to the Holy Smokes kitchen. And when we serve food at Lord of Life, which is all the time, do we always consider healthier options like fruit and vegetables? And even though we talk about a purpose-driven life, how many of us have lost that sense of purpose? We have circles for caring and sharing in our women's and men's ministries. We have neighborhood fellowship groups which can grow and expand. We're doing a lot of good things, and yet we can do so much more. We'd like to bring back more than a t-shirt from my sabbatical. Maybe this can be the catalyst for all of us to live better, longer. Thank you for giving us the time and the opportunity. And welcome to worship. Welcome to Lord of Life, a church that thrives in the 3rd chapter of life. We are healthy, happy, and whole. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal and all-merciful God, with all the angels and all the saints, we laud your majesty and might. By the resurrection of your Son, show yourself to us and inspire us to follow Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to John, the 21st chapter. After he appeared to his followers in Jerusalem, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We'll go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It's the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw the charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you've just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew that it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter said, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Tend my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he had said to him this third time, "Do you love me?" And Peter said, "Lord, you know everything, and you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the gospel of the Lord. This is one of the strangest stories in the Bible, and let me tell you why. Today's gospel takes place sometime after Easter, presumably a few weeks after Easter, a few weeks after Jesus died on a cross, a few weeks after he rose from the dead. In other words, a few weeks after the most life-changing event in the world. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Hey, Peter, you've just witnessed the resurrection of the dead. What are you going to do now? Oh, I'm going to go fishing. That's bizarre. Even the Super Bowl winning quarterback has bigger and better plans than that. Peter's life has changed forever. And what does he do? He goes back to what he knows best, which is fishing, as if nothing in his life has changed. Maybe that's not so strange. After all, how do you handle change? Many of us react to change by returning to what we know best, to what is familiar. It's not uncommon later in life to rekindle old friendships, to revisit old haunts, habits, and hobbies. In a life that's constantly changing, in a life that can abruptly change, we find comfort in what's familiar and unchanging. We take a trip to Bountiful. So a few weeks after the resurrection, Peter the fisherman returns to fishing. It appears that his story will end right where it began, because this is where Peter first met Jesus, fishing on the Sea of Galilee. In fact, when Luke tells the story about Peter meeting Jesus for the first time, it sounds exactly like today's gospel. Luke writes, "One day as Jesus was standing by the Lake of Gennesaret," that's the Sea of Galilee, the Sea of Tiberias, "the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon Peter, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then Jesus sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon Peter, 'Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch.' But Peter answered, 'Master, we've worked hard all night and caught nothing. But because you say so, I will let down the nets.' And when they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink." In Shakespeare's play, The Tempest, Antonio says, "What's past is prologue." Or as another sage said, "It's like deja vu all over again." Jesus calls the disciples after a night of fishing, after a frustrating night of fishing, where they come up empty. He tells them to let down their nets for a catch, and they catch so many fish that their boats begin to sink. And how do they react to the biggest catch of their lives? They pulled their boats up on the shore, they left everything, and they followed Jesus. That's how the story began. And that's almost exactly how the story ends. At the end of the gospel, a few weeks after Easter, Peter returns to his boats and his nets and another empty night at sea until Jesus intervenes. Two stories that are so similar. Peter, the fisherman, the boats and the nets, and the miraculous catches of fish. So similar, but with one big difference. A few weeks after Easter, there's some unfinished business with Peter. Do you remember what happened just before Easter? Think back to Thursday, the Last Supper, and the arrest. Think back to Peter warming himself by the fire outside while Jesus is being tried and condemned inside. From your accent, I can tell that you are from Galilee. You must be one of his disciples. I am not, Peter says. I'm not one of his disciples. I don't even know the man. Three times Peter is asked, and three times he denies knowing Jesus. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, who had just warned his disciples, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. So much changed at Easter. And now a few weeks later, Peter steps out of the boat and he sees Jesus next to the fire. I wonder what Peter thinks, how he feels. Whether he loses his appetite for fish and for fishing. Peter, do you love me? Jesus asks the question not once, not twice, but three times. He asks Peter, do you love me? Like the three times Peter denied Christ. The word forgiveness never appears in this story. And yet that is what Jesus is doing. He's forgiving Peter. Peter's life will change. In Jesus' absence, Peter will now lead the disciples. He will be the shepherd for the sheep. But before going forward, they have to go back to forgive the past, to set things straight. You can't make things right until you acknowledge what's wrong. A third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep. Peter has a new calling in life. The fisherman whom Jesus once called to be a fisher of men is now called to be a shepherd, a pastor who cares for the flock. It's a mixed metaphor, I know, and all the English teachers are gnashing their teeth because they know that sailors go fishing and shepherds go out to pasture. But life's like that, isn't it? As long as we live, we change. And we react to change by going back to what is familiar, what we know, what's comfortable. Sometimes God meets us there, not to go back, but to go forward with a new calling. And then the adventure begins all over again. Amen.
You who dwell in the shelter of the Lord.
Let us confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, for people in need, and for all of creation. Holy One of new beginnings, fill us with new life. Send us into the world as you sent your apostle Peter, to invite people to come and see your wondrous acts in Christ. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Revive ecosystems along coastlands that have been devastated by natural forces and human negligence. Reestablish plant and animal life that purifies air and water and that feeds humans and other living creatures. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Accompany laborers who get little rest from their work. Give them hope when they struggle to produce what they need. Give all who labor fair treatment and just wages. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Restore all people who cry to you for help. Especially, we remember the people of Ukraine, Afghanistan, all nations that are torn by conflict, war, famine. Turn their mourning into dancing. Clothe them with joy and put a testimony of healing and praise on their lips. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be present to faithful ones who are persecuted for following you. Sustain them by your faithfulness and give them strength in the name of Jesus. Be with those who are ill, whom we name now, who stand in need of your healing hand to bring strength, wholeness, and healing. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And may the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the God of all grace bless you now and forever. Amen.